In this tutorial, I'm going to show you how you can create your very own WordPress website that will display your services to your audience in a sleek and professional way. You're going to save yourself thousands of dollars by not having to pay a developer. Plus, you're going to have the skill set to make all future changes and updates to your website. And I assure you that anyone, even a beginner, can follow along with this tutorial, as there are no advanced design skills or coding necessary. So let me show you what we're going to cover in this tutorial. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to design our very own logo from scratch using Canva, the free version. And then I'm going to help you come up with the content for your website using a template that I've designed myself. And you'll find the link to the template in the description of this video. This template is going to serve as an important document that you're going to refer back to many times throughout this tutorial. And then I'm going to show you how you can implement a blog on your website and even start selling some digital products, which are great for creating some passive income. But that's not all. Then I'm going to show you how you can let your customers book an appointment with you quickly and easily. We're going to ensure your website is optimized for search engine optimization, making sure that the images are optimized and that there's adequate caching on your website. We're going to make sure your website has all of the relevant legal pages it needs and that it's fully optimized for mobile. We're going to install an SSL certificate. That means that your customer details are kept secure. Feel free to use the timestamps in the description of this video to skip forward to places that you're interested in, or just work through the tutorial step by step. If you would like to skip forward 5 seconds, then just use the right hand arrow on your keyboard. And similarly, if you want to go back 5 seconds, just hit the left hand arrow. You can also adjust the speed of this tutorial to suit your needs. If you appreciate the time that I've spent putting together this tutorial, then please hit the like button. And if you want to know more about creating an amazing website that really works for your business, then consider subscribing to my channel. So if you're ready, let's grab our laptop and get started. To make our logo, we're going to go to canva.com. There are many ways you can create a logo for free, but I personally like Canva as there are a lot of pre-built templates and a lot of customizability. So the first thing we need to do is go to canva.com and go over to create a design. Then click on logo. That's going to give us the right dimensions. Going to give us a square shape to start with. And you're going to see that it's going to give you some pre-built templates here. Well, what you can do is put in some words here that describe your business to help Canva come up with a pre-built design for you. So I quite like this template, so I'm going to just click on it. Obviously, you can see some of these are only available with Canva Pro, and the others are freely available to download, and you don't have to pay anything. So it's up to you whether you want to sign up for an account with Canva, or you can also use their 30-day free trial. So I'm going to give this one a go because I quite like this idea. So you can see that we have all of these items are grouped at the minute because we can see this little ungroup text here when we click on any of the items. So in order to customize anything, we need to click on ungroup. And now we can move these around the page as we like. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put in our name here. That's our name. And then we're just going to put in a little caption here. And you can see to edit any of these items, you just need to click on them. But what I'm going to do is I like when we have the icon to the side and the text beside that. So I'm going to just move these about, play about with them a little bit. And I kind of like this kind of design. I'm going to change the font as well with this title here. So you just select the font and then go to, nope, not that one. This one here is all the different fonts. So there's one I like. Where is it? This one, Alice. I quite like that one. And you can change the color of the text by going to here, selecting whatever color you want. These are your default colors, but you can also pick whatever color you want from this palette. Or if you have a hex code, then you can pop it in there to make life easy. So what we want to do is we want to make sure that our logo takes up the full room that we can on the space that we have. And the reason for that is we want to download our logo in the largest size we can, because it's going to be very hard to increase the size of our logo in the future. So once we have a large enough logo size, we can use that on a lot of different things, whether it's for print or our website. And we can decrease the size on our website, but we will struggle to make it larger. So I'm just going to play with the bite with this till I'm happy with the positioning of the text and the icon. All right, I'm quite happy with that. So if you do decide to go with Canva Pro, you can download this and just select transparent background. And that's going to be ready to go. But I'm going to show you how to do it for free, how to get the transparent background using a tool called Lunapic. But first, what I want to do is I want to create two different versions of our logo. This one will look great on a white background, but what if we have a dark background? We want to still be able to use the same logo. So what we're going to do is we're going to go down here and we're going to duplicate this page. And this one then is going to be the one that will look good on a dark background. So we're going to change the color of the text to white. Same with this text. And I know you can't see it here. In order to allow you to see that, we can change the background color to a darker color. So now we have two versions. We have our light background logo and our dark background logo. So now we're ready to download our logos. All we need to do is go over here to share and download. Like I said, with Canva Pro, you can just select transparent background. If you'd rather not use Canva Pro, then just download them as they are, for I will show you now how to edit the logo so that the background is transparent. So we're just going to go over to this tool called Lunapic, and we're going to go up to upload. I'm going to upload our file. This is the one I downloaded off of Canva. So the one for our light background. We're going to go over to edit, back to down to the bottom for a transparent background. And what we want to do is click on the color that we want to make transparent. Then click transparent color, because that will make all of the white transparent. Click on apply. So now our background is transparent, but we want to make one other change, because currently this file includes all of this squared area here. But what we want to do is we only want to include this area, because this is our logo. We don't need all this empty space. So what we're going to do is we're just going to crop, edit, and then crop image. Now we can just select the piece that we want to keep. Click on crop, and you can see now that we only have the logo, we don't have all the empty space. We can just click on download now and save that file. And we want to do that for the other version of our logo too. Just go to upload. We're going to do the same again. Go to edit, transparent background. Select the color that we want to make transparent. Hit apply and then crop again. And then save our image. Make sure you're selecting PNG because we need to keep that transparent background. So now you can see here that we have the cropped image with a transparent background. So this is ready to be used on any of the marketing material that we want on our website, more importantly. Before we jump in and start building our website, we want to make sure we know what we're actually going to put on our website. With that, I mean, what text are we going to write? What images are we going to write? Do we have our social media links? What colors are we going to use? That's why I created this amazing website content template. and you'll be able to access this in the description of this video. And basically spend some time going through this document. And for instance here, go to all of your social media accounts, grab the link to each and paste the link in here. If you do this once now and save this document, this will speed up things considerably whenever we go to actually using them in our website. The next section here is our color codes. And this is if you have a logo already, you can simply go to your Canva account and check what the code is for our logo. So I'm going to go back to my logo and then I'm going to make sure I know what the hex code is for this logo. And for that, I can either use Canva itself. You can see if we hover over the color, we see the hex code is 66AB48. Or you can use the color picker tool, just hover over it, click on it, and you'll see there that is the hex code. So I'm going to copy that and go back over to my template. I'm going to pop that in there. And if you had any other colors that you wanted to use in your website, you can pop more of those here. Having that there where you can quickly go and copy will speed up things greatly going forward. Now there's other spots here now where you want to take a bit of time and really think about your business and putting it into words. This is just selling yourself sentence. Just be a couple of sentences that quickly and concisely describes your business and the benefit that it provides. Take a little bit of time and just try and just put a couple of sentences in here that really sell yourself and your business. Here's your elevator pitch. This is whenever you are stuck in an elevator at a business conference, let's say, and someone says, "Hi, what do you do?" And you will tell them this. You have maybe 30, 60 seconds to answer. You want to encapsulate what you do, what your business is, in as quick a way as possible. So pop that in there. You want to think about what you do, why you do it, who you serve and how you serve them. I want to talk about who is your ideal customer then. We don't want to be targeting absolutely everyone in our business. We want to narrow down who we target because it's going to be much easier for us to speak directly to those people if we're not trying to reach absolutely everybody in the area. So try and describe who your ideal customer is. Who is it is that you're targeting with your business? Who do you want to be actually reading the content on your website? This section here is for you to write what the services are that you provide. And again, you want to put this together into a concise way. You're not rambling, but it really lets someone know exactly what services you provide in the most simplest language you can. Don't use fancy language. Don't use big words. Keep it simple. As if I'm your website developer and you're trying to communicate to me exactly what you do. Pop those services in this section. And then if you think about what are the benefits that your customers may experience after having worked with you, you know, maybe you provide reflexology. What are the benefits of that? Is that greater relaxation? Is that better health? Is that better gut health? You know, try and be as specific as possible. How are you different from others that provide similar products or services? This is where you want to differentiate yourself. This is the about section. So we're going to use this for the about section of your website. So if we spend a bit of time now thinking about what we might want to put into that section. Talk about yourself, but also talk about yourself in relation to how you can help your customers. What do you think they will want to know? Would they want to know that you're qualified, what experience you have? Pop in some personal details there as well, how long you've been in operation, things like that. If you have any testimonials, simply take them. You can take them from a Google account, you can take them from Facebook, wherever else. Anytime you've got some feedback from someone, copy and paste them and pop them in here. And anything else you might think you need to put onto this template, what you want to do then is save this as a bookmark. Anything that I want to access quite often, really quickly, is I bookmark it. So you can just click on this one, bookmark this tab. And anytime you want to just get your hex keys for your color codes or access any of this information, you can do that in a matter of seconds. Once you've collated a lot of this information, you're ready to move on to start building our website. Now that we have our logo and we have our content prepared, we're ready to go start building our website. What I want you to do is I want you to search for a website called SiteGround. This is who I use for all my website hosting needs. There are, of course, other hosts out there. And perhaps you already have your hosting service and you can skip this section. But if you need your hosting, then SiteGround is a good place to start. So we're going to go to their website. And you can see that it starts off with just $2.99 a month, which is very affordable for our first year. Gives us a chance to get our website off the ground without having to spend too much. So what you want to do is you want to start now and you want to go through this process of purchasing your hosting. Whenever you're shown which plan you want, I would go with this first one. It gets you one website, which is all you need. It gives you everything you need. You get a free domain. You get free email. You get a free SSL, which makes your website secure. This is more than enough to get us started. So I just select this plan. And you can see now that excluding VAT, that will come to $35.88. Now, if you don't already have a domain, you will definitely need a domain. A domain is this little bit that comes up in the URL, this section up at the top. It's basically your website.com or .net, .org, .co.uk, whichever you choose. So this wants to be concise and relevant to you. It could be your name. It could be your business name, something similar. You get a free domain with this hosting plan. So you need to just make sure that it is available. Obviously, more than one person can't use the same domain. So pop in your domain here and then you want to pick your extension. This is this little bit here. So these are your .com, .eu. .com will be the most well-known website extension. So go with .com if it is available. If it is not available on that, you can look at some of these other options. And then you have your country specific one. So if you're in Australia, it's AU. Ireland is .ie. You have the .co.uk for United Kingdom. So all of these ones are an option. You can choose the domain that's relevant to your country. And then there are a couple of different ones as well you can use. These ones are a little bit lesser known, so I would recommend sticking with one of these ones, definitely.com, if you can. Spend a little time making sure you get the right domain for you, because this isn't easy to change at a later date. Then we just need to continue and it'll tell you whether this is available or not. My domain is cool. Let's see if that is available. It's not available, but it's going to give you a couple of alternative options here. So you might want to pick one of them, or you might want to go back and change your domain in order to continue. And then you want to put this all in your cart. Obviously, this domain is free, but you want to go through the process now of signing up for your website hosting. Now you want to go and fill in all of the information here and then your payment information. You can see that you can pay for your 12 months, or you can go monthly, which makes the price a little bit more expensive. You can pay a little more for a longer term, but actually the 12 months one is the best deal. Domain registration, you're getting that. We don't need any of this extra stuff, so we just need to pay $44.13 to get started. Pay that now and we'll be ready to go. Once that is completed, you'll be able to log into your account. You'll be able to see and all of the services you have with SiteGround. Once you're ready to create your website within SiteGround, it's going to offer to let us start a new website or migrate an existing website. So if you have a website with a different website host, you can transfer that one over. If you select this one, the SiteGround team will help you complete that. But for now, we're going to start a new website. So we're going to select this one. What we want to do is we want to select the one that has WordPress and WooCommerce, because we're actually going to create an online store. There's going to be an online store component to this website. So we're going to select this one. And now it's going to ask us for our WordPress login credentials. This is what the details that you're going to use whenever you're logging into your WordPress dashboard. We don't need any of these extra things for now. Just click on confirm. No, thank you. we don't need this. This will give you daily backups, hourly backups actually, but we have daily backups with SiteGround anyway. We're not going to add those right now. We're going to click on finish. Now SiteGround is going to install WordPress on our hosting account. Now, once our website is created, we're ready to access our WordPress dashboard. So in order to do that, you can just go to this little section, Login Admin. And I find this tends to happen for some reason. It's a little bit of a glitch. So all you need to do is go up to the URL here. And I'm using a temporary host for the sake of this tutorial, but your website domain will appear here. What I want to do is I'm going to select this last part of the domain and I'm just going to type in admin and then click enter. And that's going to bring us to our WordPress login. So you need to put in here the credentials that you put in whenever you created the website. Now this is going to prompt us to work through a startup wizard, but we're actually not going to use this because this will pick a theme for you, help you get started basically. But if you follow through this tutorial, you don't need this wizard. So we're going to just exit wizard. We're going to go straight into our WordPress. So here is our WordPress dashboard all up and running. So you see down the left-hand side here, this is where you access all the different parts of your WordPress. So you see we have WordPress or WooCommerce already because we opted to install that right at the start. These are all WordPress or product related tabs, I suppose. This is posts tab. This is where at a later time we are going to create a blog. And this is all of our blogs are created as posts. The media, this is where all of our photos, any images are kept. Any pages, these are the pages that we will have in our website. So our homepage, our contact page, etc. Any comments, if we're writing a blog, we might have comment section and we can access all of the comments there. Like I said, this is all to do with the shop section. Appearance, plugins, users. We're going to use these as we go through this process. So you'll see how to be able to use them as we actually use them in practice. So the first thing we want to do is we want to make sure we have the correct theme installed for our website. So what we need to do in order to do that and to change our themes is we want to click on this one, appearance. This is how we search for new themes or install new ones. And we can see here that these are the ones that we have currently on our website. This one is the one that is active. So what we want to do is we're going to go to add a new theme. And we are going to search for the Astra theme. And you can see this is our Astra theme here. So we want to install that on our website. And this is just putting the relevant files onto our WordPress. And then we want to click on activate. We can click on live preview and just see what our website looks like currently when we've done literally no work. So there we go. You actually have a website sort of, we're not going to leave it like this, okay? So we want to name our website. So you can see this is currently called My WordPress. So what we're going to do is we're going to go to Site Identity. And we want to start customizing this theme. And if we just click on this Site Title and Logo Settings, you can see that this is the logo that's currently being used. So you have your logo already created if you follow through this tutorial. So what you need to do is just click on Change Logo. Select files, and from your computer then, you want to find the logo that you've already created. You want to give this logo a title and an alt text. So this is going to be Amy Forest logo. So we're going to copy that and pop that into our alt text as well. And then select. We're going to skip cropping. Now, we're not going to worry about how this looks yet. But the site title you want to have as your business name or your name or whatever you think is relevant, your business name or your name, depending on what your business is. So I am just going to have it as Amy forest something like that. Your tagline then, it wants to describe in just a few words what your business does. So I've had, Amy is a registered dietitian, so I've said, helping you achieve great health through food. It's really simple, really simple description of your website. Site icon then. This is what will appear. If you can notice just right at the tab section, we have the little WordPress icon currently, and then all the different websites have their own little icon. So we want to create that as well. What I want to do is I want to have our icon is this little icon section here, but we need to remove it from the overall logo that we've currently created. So what we're going to do is we're going to go back to our Canva. Do you remember where we created our logo? So this is the logo that I created before. I'm going to duplicate this one. And now I'm going to delete the text. And we want to have this as large as we can within the space that we have, basically. Something like that. And then we want to save that again. So we're going to save it, we're going to download it. If you have Canva Pro, click on transparent background. If not, we will go and just make sure we're only downloading the one that we want. So we don't want them all, we just want page 2. Okay. I'm going to click on download. We're going to save that. Because this is going to be our icon. Then we're going to pop over to Lunapic. We're going to upload our file. And we're going to make sure that we have a transparent background. And you can see there that it is made all of the white transparent. We're going to click on apply. And we're going to save it. File and save. Save as PNG. We go back over to our WordPress. Click on site icon. It'll bring us to our media library again. We need to click on upload files, select files, and then, oh no, that's not the right one, I don't think. Don't think it has a transparent background. Go again, this one. Okay, we're gonna do the same again where the title and the alt text. Short description just helps Google understand our website if we put in a title and an alt text into all of our images. Again, we're going to skip cropping. So that means that this little icon will now appear on the top of our tab. Now we're going to click on publish to make sure we save all of our changes. So that's our title and tagline. We're now going to go back to our WordPress dashboard. So we're going to click this little X. Take us out of this. Now what we're going to do is we're going to go to plugins. We're going to add a new plugin. And this plugin is called Starter Templates. And this plugin is going to speed up the website design process and the creation process. And it's going to mean that we don't need to design everything from scratch, because if you want a website absolutely designed and built from scratch, then you probably are worth getting a professional developer to do it for you. But if you're doing this on your own, you want to keep things as simple as possible, and there are ways of being able to create amazing websites without having to design everything from scratch. So I'm going to show you how to do that. So this is our plugin. We're going to click on install now, and then once again, activate. Now it's going to run us through a startup wizard. We're not going to use the AI website builder. I have tried it and I'm not completely convinced by it yet. We're going to avoid AI and actually make our website ourselves. So we're going to go with this classic starter templates. First thing we need to do is we need to go up to the right hand side here and see where it says block editor. We want to select Elementor. This is going to mean that all of these templates are going to work with a page builder called Elementor. Okay, for some reason that seems to be a little bit glitchy. So what we're going to do is we're going to go back to plugins. Didn't actually offer us any starter templates. Let's go and see below the starter templates here, get started. Let's try again. Click on classic starter template. Elementor. There we go. So now we have all these different types of templates. They will be automatically created for us without us having to do a thing. You'll see that there are premium and free options. You'll see premium on here and you'll have to pay for those if you want to use them. It's not a lot. And if you really, really like one of the templates, it might be worth doing. I think it's like 70 or 80 quid a year. So you can have a look through these and see which one you think would, you know, fit your business best. I would suggest going with the simplest one, because in the long run, that's what we want. We want to keep it simple. We want to keep it clean. I'm going to keep with the theme of creating the website for our dietitian, Amy Forrest. The one that I really like is this one called Hope. Not only does it look lovely and clean and a nice professional looking design, it actually gives you little tips in the text that's already there to help you come up with the text yourself. So when you're ready, just select which one you want. And this is our template, so we're going to modify this. But you can see then we have our different typefaces or fonts that we can use. And you literally just go with something that you like the look of. Quite like that. What do you think? Yeah, I quite like this one. But you go through these and see which one you like the look of. We have a color palette here, but we're not going to worry about this too much because it only gives you this selection. So if you didn't already have a logo or a color scheme in mind, then you could just select one of these and you'll see that little parts of it will change every time we pick a different color scheme. But it doesn't matter right now what this is because we're going to go back in and change this. But for now, just click continue. We don't need any of these. So we're going to click continue. They just want to know a little bit about you and your business. Submit and build my website. And this is going to create that starter template website for you. So that means you can just go in and edit each of the pages, which is what we're going to do next. There we go. We have started, we've selected our template and we've created the website. We can view the website now. And you'll see that we have this Hope template with all the information there that has come with the template. So what we need to do now is we need to go in and start modifying it. And we will go through and we'll do that page at a time. So you see, we have our standard pages, our home, about, services, contact, and we have a phone number here. You can choose to leave this or not. It's completely up to you. But you'll see that we really have a good looking website out of the box and ready to start modifying it. So in order to get back to our WordPress dashboard, all you need to do is hover over the name of your website and click on dashboard. That takes us back to our main WordPress dashboard. What we want to do is we want to go to pages over on the left-hand side. And you'll see that the starter template has created a bunch of pages that we already need. So we don't need to go through and create all these pages out of the box. We have our about page. These are our checkout pages, our cart checkout. We have our contact page, our home. We actually don't need this one. We just need this one. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to delete that one. And my account privacy policy, we will look at that later. Refund and returns policy, again, we will complete these at a later date. And our shop page, because that's where when we create our digital products for our dietitian, that's where those will appear. So by installing WooCommerce, WooCommerce has automatically created the relevant pages for our shop. So now we're going to start with our homepage. In order to edit this, we want to use Elementor, the page builder. It makes things much easier to modify the content on your page, I feel, using something like Elementor. So what I would do with this is I would right click on that, edit with Elementor, and open link in a new tab. So I have this, my WordPress dashboard open, but I also have my home page in the editor open as well. Yeah, they're using AI for pretty much everything now, but I don't need that. So this is our editor. So, and you'll see here, we have this little bit here that we can move around the page, and it helps with our structure. It just shows us all of these different sections that are already created. But I'm going to close this down for the moment. You can keep it out of the way if you like. So what we want to do, this is area we have, this is our hero area, or everything above the fold is what appears immediately as soon as someone comes to our homepage. So over on the left-hand side here, you can see that this is our editor information. So this is how we change all of the detail that's over here. And you can see if I hover over the different parts, you'll see there's a little box around it. And if we want to edit that, we can either just click on the item or click on this little pencil icon here. And you'll see here that this is appropriately selected here. This is editing the header. And then if we click select the button, you'll see that we're now editing the button. And we can close this little editor over if we want to see how our website appears as it would basically in the real life. So what we're going to do is we're going to go through all of the content on this homepage and we're going to modify it appropriately. So first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to open up my editor again. I'm going to pop some text in here that I think Amy should put on her website. So what I want to do is I actually want to have this little bit of text that all stays on one line. You can see it's kind of going on to two lines there. So we want to do, I think we need to, in order to select this whole section, you can see this little pink tab here. If we click these little dots, that means that this whole section is now selected. And you can see over on this left-hand side, this is a container that we have selected, and this is the width of it. So if we change this width to a little bit wider, you can see now this section has become wider. So now I have my name and my title, you know, sitting on one line, which I think looks much better. We can adjust the height of this, what is currently set to 100% of the viewport height, which is the what is seen when someone comes onto our site. This total area is 100% of the screen size. What I want to do is I actually want to add in a little bit of text underneath this title here. So in order to add a section, we want to click on this little add element and we're going to add in a text editor section. So I'm going to drag this over underneath this section here. Now you see that this has come with, it's not matching the current theme of our site so far. So what we need to do is we want to change the text, obviously. And this is where we want to refer back to our content template over here, because we will have created a lot of this text already. So you could use some of the text here from your selling yourself sentence or from your elevator pitch in order to encapsulate in as few words and sentences as possible what it is that you do. Remember that people aren't going to spend a lot of time reading a lot of text on your website. So you want to get your message across in as little time as possible. And now we want to edit the style of this text because we can't actually read it now. So we want to select this style icon. The text color is here. So we want to make it white, the same as that. We have our global colors, which are currently all already in there from our starter template. I'm going to change it to white to to match the rest of this, but I also want to center it as well. So I'm going to go to alignment, and this little one is center to make it all running down the middle of the page. I want to make the text a little bit bigger. So I'm going to go to this typography where we can edit the typography. The family we don't need to touch because we remember we already selected our font at a previous step. So we don't need to touch that. But if you ever need to change any how the text appears, this is where you do it within the typography section. So I'm just going to increase the size of that a small bit. And again, I'm going to close off this section to make sure I can see what it looks like without the editor in the way. Okay. And this button then, this is our call to action. What you want website visitors to do will depend on what your business is. But try and think of how will you convert these website visitors into customers? What is the one simple step that you want them to take in order for them to become customers of yours? So what we're going to do with this dietitian, we're going to allow them to book a 15 minutes discovery call. And that's a free appointment that they can book so that they can have a quick chat to make sure that we are the right fit for them. We're going to be able to provide the right service for them. So at this stage, we're just going to change the text here. So I selected the button, and over here you'll see the editing. So I'm going to say book discovery call. Okay, we don't need to worry about the link or anything yet because we need to actually create this page. We're going to do that at a later point. So that's our hero area. The text anyway. So I'm not sure whether this sort of is a beautiful picture, okay, but not sure whether it's completely appropriate for this website. So what we want to do is we want to select this section and we want to change this background image. So once you've selected the section, you can go to style and you'll see that here is the image that's currently being used. All we need to do is click on this. And these are all the images that have been pulled in from the starter template. But we want to use some of our own images. So we want to go to upload files and you want to select an image from your computer. Now there are lots of ways you can get free images for your website. If I just show you now, there's one called Pixabay. That's a great website for getting free images, royalty-free images. You don't need to pay for most of these. So let's say we have a dietitian. So what kind of images would we want for this dietitian? Let's say food. Would that be appropriate? So some of these are really nice. You want to make sure you get the right shape of image because remember, on our website, this is kind of a rectangle going across the page, isn't it? We want to make sure we get one that is that rectangle shape, not one of these ones that's kind of longish because it's not going to fit in that area nicely. So what we might do is, I really like this image with all the different foods. So I'm going to select this one and I'm going to download that one. We are going to make sure it is wide enough. So I'm going to select this size. I want to make sure it's wide enough to fit the whole way across the screen without becoming blurry. So I'm going to click on download. And we're going to save that image, the nice healthy food image. So we're going to go back over to our website then, choose image, upload files, and find the image then that we just saved. I'm going to take a look and see what that one looks like. Again, we're going to put an appropriate title and alt text. The alt text is what will appear or what will be read out by a screen reader. Let's say someone is accessing our website that actually has visual impairment and has a screen reader instead. So this will let them know what content is on the website. I'm going to select that one. And now you can see that this is a bit more of an appropriate picture, isn't it? Except it's making it a little bit hard to see the text because it's so many different colors going on. I just get rid of this editor, then we can see what that looks like. So what we're going to do is we're going to put a background overlay on this in order to make the whole thing a little bit darker, which will make our text pop out a little bit more, it would be a little bit easier to read. So what we want to do is we want to make sure that this section is selected by clicking on the little dots up here. Then we will go down to over here, we see background overlay. Click on that and we're going to add our background overlay then. So we can see this is a nice dark color. So we can see here there actually already was a background overlay. All we need to do is change the opacity so that it's darker. So you can see the images clearly, but the text is now popping out much easier. So now, I think that looks lovely. We have the food theme and we have the short bit of text describing exactly what benefits we're going to have if we work with Amy Forrest. Now, I'm happy with that section for now. When you're happy with that, make sure you click on publish. Now we're going to move on to the next section, move down here. So this is where we're going to put our the different services that Amy actually provides. We want to get to the point really quickly, allow our website visitors to know exactly how we can help them. But we can change this text. We're going to say, if you ever make a change you're not happy with, just go Control and Z. And that will undo the last thing that we just did. So I wanted to just select this and I want to change the text certified. So we're going to say registered dietitian based in Oakland, California. Yeah, that's fine. You can put whatever location you're in there or whatever text you want in there. Problems I can help with. I'm going to change this to services I provide. So now we have the different services that you provide. So you can have all three of these, or if you had more services, you could duplicate this area to provide more. So let's just see if I this is how we get up this little structure box here, if there's ever anything. So if you ever need to select this container that contains these smaller containers within it, let's say we wanted to duplicate this because let's say we had six services and not three services. You can use this structure box here to make sure we've selected the appropriate one. Because you can see here, if I click on this, we have the image. Then if we click on this, it's like the column that's in that contains the image and the text, but we want to select the container that contains all three of these. And that would be mean selecting this one. And you can see now that we have the line the whole way around it. So let's say we wanted to duplicate this because we wanted to have more services. So we make sure we're selecting this one. And we're going to right click and say duplicate. Okay, that is not done what I asked. So I'm going to go Control and Z. Click on this one. Okay, now I'm going to right click on that there and go duplicate. So now you're seeing that it's duplicated this whole entire section. So let's say if you wanted to have more services, now you could add in more services there. Get rid of this and you can see there that we have that larger area to add in more sections here. But I don't need that for now. I only have the three sections. So I'm going to go ahead, I'm going to delete that. And I'm going to concentrate on creating this section now. So again, just select all of the different sections and modify them on this left-hand side here. We want to make sure we have appropriate images in these sections that demonstrate the point we're talking about in the text below. So if you have your own images, then feel free to add them in here. But I'm going to use Pixabay to find something kind of appropriate that would look good in these sections. So we just need to click on the little pencil icon over the image. And over here, we'll see choose image. So I'm going to go again. No, do you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to use this image because I think that's quite a nice image. I'm going to pretend that's my Amy, the dietitian. So our title and our alt text. Kind of looks a bit blurry, doesn't it? I'm not sure I'm happy with that one. So I'm going to go to Pixabay and see if I can find anything here. And you'll see, no matter what images we add in here, the images will continue to be exactly the right shape with exactly the right spacing. This is one thing that can be really difficult when you're trying to design a website and build it from scratch. So I'm happy with that services section then. What I am going to do though, is I'm going to put a button underneath this section that will lead to my services page. What I'm going to do is I'm going to have this button here. I'm going to right click on it and I'm going to say duplicate. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to drag it down to, will it go here? Okay, so we'll put this in here. So this will allow someone to book their discovery call. Kind of want it aligned left with the same as the text here. So what we'll do is select the button, go to style, and we're going to position it to the left. And then we're going to duplicate that again. I'm going to drag it over under here. This one is going to be called View Recipes. I'm going to duplicate that. Drag it over to here. You can see the little pink line indicating where it will appear. I'm going to call this one View Services. So we have this section. These buttons are going to all lead to the relevant sections once we have created them. But for now, we're going to move on and do this next section. So remember, we saved some of our testimonials in a previous part of the tutorial, and this is where you want to add one of these in. So go ahead and put in some relevant testimonials here. What my clients say. So this suggests that they would have a testimonial page. But we're not going to create that. I don't think we need a testimonials page. So what we're going to do is we're just going to delete this button. So right click, delete. So we just have this nice testimonial. Ask people for an image if you can. If you don't have the image, you could just delete that. Try and get a name or even put past client, something like that. And then you can pop in your testimonial in here. If you don't have a testimonial, you don't want to have this section, you can click on this little X button and that will delete the whole container. And then we just need to move on to this about section. And this is where we want to take some of that content that we used the template for before. Again, you want to talk about yourself, but in a way that your customers are going to care. Give them a reason to trust you. What is your experience? What is your qualifications? What are your skills that will help them trust you and trust that you have what they need in order to gain the results that they want? So what we're going to have is this section, this button will lead to my services. So see my services or view services. You can change that as you wish by clicking on the button and the text there. And then more about me, we can leave that as it is because it'll link to our about page. So in order to link that, we want to make sure the button is selected. Come over here and you'll see the link button. I want to select about. We just type in about there, that will come up and that will automatically link to our about page. So we want to just go through and make sure we edit all of these details. You want to have a nice image of yourself in here. It really is nice to have your face at some point through your website. Faces help people understand you, who you are. It's nice to have a face, especially a smiley one, a friendly one. It has a warm feeling. And especially if it's your face, people will think that they start to get to know you a little bit. They know who they're working with. So I'm going to find an image. Let's say we'll just select this one. Okay. Anyway, that's fine. So just create that section as you wish with the information that you've already created from your template. So this section here, what we're going to do is we're going to give another opportunity for someone to book our discovery call. So I'm going to select that button. And again, we've seen that the text is kind of a bit narrow here. We want this to come and stay on one line. So what I need to do is I just need to select this overarching section and we want to adjust the width of the content. So let's just, yeah, pop it like that. Just put a little bit wider. Yeah. So ready to improve your health and another little sentence here. And if we wanted to add any more sections, we would just click on this one, add a new container, or there are different templates that we can use and we can pop in. These are blocks. You'll see that there are entire pages that you can add in. Any templates that you've saved will be in here. But for now, I'm happy with that. And once we've done a page, we want to make sure that our page is going to look good on all devices. So we're going to adjust our mobile optimization as we go through adjusting all of these pages. So that's the next thing that we're going to do. Just going to get rid of this editor and I'm going to quick scroll down to make sure I like how everything is appearing. Oh, we didn't adjust this image. Forest is nice, but not really relevant. Let's find a nice image for this section. Now, similar again, I'm just going to adjust the overlay so that the text just appears a little bit clearer, something like that. There we go. Perfect. Now, let's just check what this looks like on tablet and on mobile. Hopefully by using the starter template, we will have ensured that this looks great out of the box without having to adjust anything. However, we're just going to double check anyway. So this is how it would look on a tablet when someone views your website. And I think that is perfect. That all looks great. These bits look great. And I don't think I'm going to have to edit any of this. Let's just check mobile. Ooh, up to the top. That looks great. You can see that these ones have been adjusted to fit nicely on mobile. That looks perfect as well. So we shouldn't need to adjust any of this, but it is a simple process to adjust things if you like. Let's say we wanted to make this text a little bit smaller. This we just select the text. Come over to our style. Into our typography, let's just say we move this text a little bit smaller. That actually looks a bit better, doesn't it? So that's the all you need to do there. I'm happy with that page. We will have to come back and obviously make sure these buttons are all linked to the right pages, but for now I'm happy with that. So we're going to click publish to see if our changes. Before we move on, I'm going to just show you how to change the color theme. You'll see all of these buttons and little bits of color here. So what we're going to do now is we're going to go back to our WordPress editor. Exit to WordPress. There's certain things that are going to be controlled on a WordPress level rather than Elementor level. And our color theme in this instance is where we will, is what will be controlled via our WordPress. So we're just going to go back to our WordPress by coming up here and clicking on our name. Then we want to go to appearance and customize. We want to go to global colors. And now these are the colors that we can now change that will match with our color theme from our logo. So do you remember our hex keys, our hex codes? This is where you get this information. So go back to your template and hopefully you will have recorded your keys here. No, hopefully this is the right one, was it? That nice green. I'm going to copy that and then I'm going to go over here and I'm going to select this color. I'm going to pop in my hex key there. And that will bring up our nice green that will link automatically with our logo. Just notice that our logo isn't on here, so we'll need to pop that in as well. For our second color, I'm going to do the same color. And you'll see that a couple of those different pieces have now changed. It should all now be linked to your branding color. While we're here, we're just going to, now we need to just change our site logo. I'm going to click change logo and grab your logo. That's not the logo, that's the icon. All right. Now we can see it here, it's very small. So we are going to increase the size of that. Now that doesn't look great, does it? The gray doesn't look good. Maybe I will use my white one. Remember what we created, both types of logos. I'm gonna change my logo and use the other one. The one that I created that will be used on a darker background. This one. Now we can see that this logo looks much better with our darker background. We're going to click on publish. Next, we're going to go through and we're going to edit the rest of our website, our base pages. So we're going to start with our about page. And again, I'm going to right click on edit with Elementor, open in a new link. And we're going to edit this page in a similar way. We're going to select each individual component and change it. So we're going to do that with the images and the text. So instead of about us, it's going to be about me. And I'm going to put a capital letter. I'm going to change this image, clicking on style on the image. And I'm going to just make sure whenever you're selecting an area that you select the right area. See where I can click on this icon here and you say that it says edit image. Whereas if I was to select here, this is actually editing the container. So I want to select the image, make sure it's selected here, and I can change the image. And all we need to do is edit the text. And we'll be able to pull in the text that we've created using our template. So this shouldn't take too long. We want to not overwhelm people with loads and loads of text, because let's be honest, people are not going to read lots and lots of text. Keep it to the key points. How can you help your customers? What is it about you that they care about? And you can see that this page has been designed perfectly in order for you to demonstrate the about you information that's most relevant to them. If you want a bit more help with coming up with content for your website, then have a look at my YouTube channel. Some of the rest of the videos there will give you a little bit more guidance when it comes to creating the content. We have another testimonial section here. So if you have another testimonial, we can put that in here. Otherwise, we can delete the section. Get rid of the editor and we're going to have a look what this looks like. Perfectly spaced. Once all of your content is in here, this will be ready to go. Well, let's just check our tablet optimization. Perfect. And on mobile. Again, absolutely perfect and ready to go. We can click on our little burger icon here. This will give us our dropdown for our mobile menu. And you can see that this is looking perfect as well. Okay, that's our about page finished and edited. Let's click on publish. Now, the next thing we're going to do is we're going to skip over to the contact page. It's another one of our base pages. One of those pages that are pretty much in all websites. We want to make it really easy for people to find our contact information. So we're just going to change over to our contact page here with this handy little dropdown that Elementor has created recently. Now, this is our contact page. Obviously, we don't want it to contact us. We want it to contact me. And I like the capitals at the start of the words, especially for titles. Change our image. Might grab another one and see if we have any in here that we can use. Food. Lovely. Let's insert that image. I'm going to just darken the background overlay again. Perfect. Whatever text you want in here, please get in touch. I would love to hear from you. Love to hear from me? No, you. I would love to hear from you. Now, this may or may not be appropriate for you. Now, all you want to do is go in here and you pop in your email, your phone number if you want it there, your address if you want it there. If you do not want these sections, all you need to do is right click on the little pencil icon and you can delete whatever section you do not need. You'll see if you select that, your images or your text that you can edit is right over here in our editor. And here are our social media buttons. So this is where we should already have all of these saved in our template, social media links. So you should have your link for Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, whatever other social media links you have. You want to just copy those to pop that in here. So once you select the button, you want to go over here and this is Twitter. You can change it to whichever one you want. So you have the Twitter icon. You can go to icon library and select a different one. Let's say you wanted YouTube. There's the YouTube icon. Although that's already there. Let's try Facebook. There's the Facebook icon. You can insert that one there. Then all you want to do is paste your link to your Facebook profile. We're going to leave the colors there because the colors are all already fitting in with our brand design. You can adjust these, but I don't think I need to. I think that looks great. So we've provided simple page where people can get in touch with us. Dead easy. All we need to do. Make sure we click publish, double check the mobile optimization. Let's go to tablet view. Let's get rid of this editor. You know, maybe I would say, okay, this section is a little bit wide. I'm going to just adjust the height of this section. So I'm going to make sure I selected it with the little dots. There's padding around our text. So in order to decrease the size of this section, we want to decrease the padding, which is under advanced. So we want to do that. We can say, let's make that 60 instead of 80. And same with the bottom. That just makes that section a little bit narrower. We don't really need quite as much room on our tablet. Whenever we're adjusting things in tablet view, it won't change anything in the normal view. Anything that you change in tablet will be applied to the devices smaller than it, but won't apply to devices bigger than it, if that makes sense. So what I want to do is I actually want to... Doesn't look good the way there's one word on the bottom there, does it? What I might do is, what if I increase the size of the text? Yeah, that actually looks better. I'd love to hear from you. Get rid of the editor so we can see it without all the jumbled stuff. Text maybe a little bit large. So we can edit that, make it a little bit in line with the text above it. Make sure we click on the little pencil icon to edit it. Go into style, typography, and we have the size here. We can just, that's a little bit better there, isn't it? A little bit smaller. Perfect. Now we just want to make sure we click publish to see if those changes. So as our base pages, our home, about, and our contact pages edited, now we want to go to our services page. And I think the simplest way to do this is to have one services page that gives the information relevant to all of the services that you provide. However, you can do it a different way, where you can have an overarching services page that then links to a complete page on that one service. That would be more if you had a lot of information you wanted to provide about the service, where it might be relevant to provide that information in an entire page, not just a small section on the overarching services page. I hope that makes sense. Let's just pop over to our services page then in order to start editing that. Because this starter template has included a handy services page. So again, we're going to go through and we're going to edit this as we've been doing. Exactly the same, edit each individual aspect. So these are the different sections we're going to use for our services. And you can see that each section is within its own container, overarching container, and then you have smaller containers within other containers in order to make up each section. So I'm going to put in the information relevant to the three services that Amy actually provides. So if we can remember, she provides one-to-one consultations, recipes, and that community. So this one here will be our one-to-one consultations. So let's say the price of a consultation is, say, I don't know, what would that be? 200 quid? Yeah, maybe. So you can see here that we can just simply edit these exactly as before. So that's a dollar sign. You can, of course, put in a pound sign or a euro sign, whichever you prefer. And that is for a one-to-one consultation. The other thing I love about this template is it actually walks you through what to put in individual sections. So tell them the benefits that they will get from their one-to-one consultation. And then we are going to link this to allow them to actually book that consultation when we set that up in a future part of this tutorial. So you can just go ahead and edit your image as well, edit all the text. See if there's any nice dietitian pictures in here. Actually, there's some lovely ones. Again, this might be somewhere where you might have your own images for this. But let's just have a look and see what this looks like. No, I think that looks great. This section then will be the tasty recipes. Again, complete the rest of the text for the service that you provide. And at a later date, once we have our shop set up, actually, we think we can actually link this to our shop. View recipes. That's going to be our shop page because we already have that shop page created. This one is our community and it actually doesn't cost anything. They will be allowed to join the free Facebook group. Free. What exactly will the service do for them? So there we go. And what we could do here then is put in the link. I'm going to put in the book a discovery call because we're really not going to allow people to book to actually join the free Facebook group at this point. They're going to want to book an appointment first, aren't they? And that means they want to book a discovery call first. Book discovery call. I'm actually going to change this one up here as well. So although they can book a one-to-one consultation, it's more realistic that people are going to want to have a discovery call first. Okay, perfect. And again, we want to make sure it looks great in a tablet. We didn't do this last little bit either. And mobile. So let's just go back up here and we'll just edit this final section here. We can say, unsure if you are ready to get started. What we can say is, don't worry. Book your free, no obligation discovery call. Okay, I'm just going to widen this section again so that the text is all on one line, similar to what I did before. Width. Okay, and then change our image again. We'll get something nice and foody. Maybe we'll have a healthy person on there. Like this one. We'll just edit the background overlay again. Make sure that our text is standing out nice and clear. It's better. Just change the text on that button. Yeah, perfect. We're just going to click publish, and that's that services page done. Now we want to create our blog post. And in order to do that, we need to go over to our pages and we need to create the new page and then call it blog. So we've just clicked on create new and we want to call this blog, or you can say blog posts or news or whatever you might like. And then what we want to do is we want to come over and we want to hit publish. Once you've done that, you can come back to your pages and you'll see here that we have now our blog posts. Now this has been set as our blog posts page. You see the way it says posts page beside here. And to set that as our post page, we go to appearance, customize, homepage settings. And you'll see here that our blog has been selected as our posts page. However, we aren't able to edit our posts page with Elementor free. We would have to upgrade to the paid version of Elementor, which I don't want to do for this tutorial. I want to show you how to do everything using just the free version of Elementor. So we're not going to have this sent as our post page. We're just going to make sure under posts page, we have this select. This is basically none. So our post page isn't selected. So I suppose the only difference is that whenever you create a new blog post, the blog posts are automatically put onto the posts page. And because we haven't got a post page selected, it's not going to automatically put it onto our blog. But I'm going to show you how you can, every time you write a new blog post, you can simply add that on using a different method, basically. So we're just going to make sure if we've made any changes here, this should be selected. Your home page should be home. Post page should say select. So it's effectively none. Make sure you hit publish and go back to our dashboard. So now we have our blog and it no longer says posts page beside it. The first thing we want to do is we actually want to create a couple of blog posts so that when we put them on our page, we can see how they're going to be displayed. So in order to create a blog post, we need to go over here to posts and then we can add new post. And this is where you will put the title of your blog post. Let's say our dietitian is writing a blog post on best foods for dry skin or something like that. And you can use Elementor to edit your blog posts, but you don't have to. You can use the WordPress editor in this instance. So basically you have your text and you have your different blocks here. So you can click this little icon here and you can add an image, a heading, a list, a gallery. You can click on this and you can browse all of the different things that you can pop in here. Best foods for dry. We've got our title. We're going to hit publish, publish again. What we want to do is we also want to have a featured image for our post. So that there's a nice little image appears when our blog post appears. And then we want to have a little bit of text. And this just helps us create a realistic looking post. You can, of course, actually create your blog post at this point if you have a blog post ready to go. Okay, so we have a little bit of text, our title, and our featured image. That should be enough for now. I'm going to go and create another blog post. So we're going to go view posts, add another post. Let's say best foods for oily skin. Maybe our dietitian specializes in skin issues. Pop in the same dummy text. Make sure we click posts here, set featured image. I'm just going to pop an image here from our gallery. You might also want to make sure that you've categorized your blog posts. So this, you don't want to really leave them uncategorized. You want to start building up different categories of blog posts. So we're going to click add new category. This one is going to go under skin. So it's under skin. Now we want to publish. Publish again. Now what happens? We need to put our blog posts onto our blog page. So in order to do that, we need to go back to pages. And in order to, again, use the free version of Elementor, we need another plugin that's going to help us pop quickly and easily our blog posts onto this blog page. So we're going to go to plugins, add a new plugin. We're going to look for grid. This one, post grid, and install now, and click activate. Now, we want to make sure this one, resource load time, is set to Elementor Gutenberg. Make sure we click save changes. Now we're going to go back to our pages and our blog page. We want to edit with Elementor. This will bring us back to our familiar Elementor editor. We want to try this one. Yeah. And now we want to add, we need to go to add element. So now we also have this new post grid section. So this is going to allow us to put our blog posts in here quite quickly and easily. So let's just see what this looks like. We're going to drag over this grid layout into our space that we've created with Elementor. And now you can see that this is brought through our blog posts without a whole pile of work, without a whole pile of energy. This has just beautifully created our page with our blog posts in it. We want to make sure we have an appropriate title, not section title. So you'll see that we have all the options over here on the left-hand side, and you can choose different layouts. And obviously, if you pay for the pro version, you get more layouts, but you can play around with which one you like best. So I quite like that one. Post title is under style. I'm not going to play about with this too much. Design-wise, I think it's quite good. Thumbnail, excerpt, metadata. Metadata. This is this information here. So you can see this is by, and this is my email address. You can see the category, you can say the date. I'm gonna click on metadata because I don't really want most of that stuff kind of appearing. Oh yeah, here we go, metadata. So you can choose to take away your post date, post category, author, or what we can do is just not show the metadata altogether. So now all you have is your title and that little bit of text that kind of introduces the blog post. Section title is here. So we want to say blog posts. We can change the style. So you can see this is a dot on a border. What's this one look like? Yeah, don't really like that. You can play about with which one you like the best. Section title. Bar color. See if we can change the bar color. Yeah, that changes our bar color. So what we can do if we want to have the same color as our blog post here, we can go and use our color picker, quickly and easily grab our color, grab the hex code for that, pop that in. to here. That'll mean, oh, the little this is the line I changed. That's fine. I can pop it in here as well. So now I have all of that the same color as our branding on our website. So now I quite like that. What I might do is just try and edit the colors of this button here a little bit. Let's see, content, style. This is our read more button. So the text color, that's fine. We want to change, because see, it's changing to blue on hover. So if we go here, we can click hover. Our border that is going blue, we want it to go green, like our color. We want the text color to go our same green. So now you can see when we hover over it, it turns to our branded green color. And I think that looks pretty good. The only thing that I want to adjust a little bit. Not much though. I think it looks really good. You can just imagine now if someone comes to our blog post page and you have a selection of blog posts here. This will look really good in displaying the different posts that you have. And these little buttons will directly take people to the actual blog post that they want to read. Just going to space it out a little bit. So I'm going to bring it a little bit down from the top. So in order to do that, I'm going to select this main container, go to advanced. Up a little bit of margin at the top. So I'm going to unlink the values. What am I going to put? Maybe 50 pixels at the top. Might put 50 at the bottom as well. And I get rid of our editor to see what that looks like. That looks a bit better, doesn't it? A little bit of space at the top and the bottom. Now you can see that our menu up here doesn't actually contain our blog page. So what we want to do is we want to go back, make sure we've saved everything here. We're going to go back and add our blog page to our menu. So in order to edit our menu, we need to go back to our dashboard, exit to WordPress, back to the dashboard. So we want to go to appearance and menus. So here's our main menu. That's what our menu is called. We want to make sure we select blog and we want to click add to menu. And I think what I might do is you can drag and drop these anywhere. So you can see this has gone as a sub item. I don't want it as a sub item. I want it as an item on its own. So now we have all of the different items in our menu. And it's the same way if we wanted to add any of these other pages to our menu. Maybe you want a My Account page on the menu as well. All you need to do is select this and add to menu. So I'm just going to save the menu from now and then we'll go and view our site. And make sure that has appeared. So now we have home, blog, about, services, contact. I'm just going to change that so that blog is in capital letters as well. Label, we want to make that in capitals so that it fits the rest of the styling for our menu. So I saved that, we'll go back to our page, refresh the page, and now we can see that they're all in capitals. So that's how you add a blog post to your website. So now I want to show you how you can create a blog post template so that you don't need to redesign a blog post every time you want to write a blog. So in order to be able to do that, we're going to go back to our WordPress dashboard. We're going to go over, hover over templates, and then we can go to add new. And we're going to select a page template and we're going to call this our blog post template. I'm going to create template. Now we want to start comprising a simple blog layout. So I'm just going to go with this layout and we're going to drag and drop a few items from this left-hand panel over into our editor screen. So first thing I'm going to drag across is a heading because that's going to be our blog post heading, obviously. Now we want a little subsection that goes underneath the heading. And then the next thing you might want to have is an image to go with your blog post. So we're going to drag over a image. Like that. And then let's say you might want to have a content area. Or a contents area. So what we're going to do for that, we're going to click add again. We're going to add a container, a new container underneath this one. In here. We're going to change the background of this one to a little bit of a darker color. Go to style, background, color, let's say, we just leave it kind of a grayish color. Might lighten that slightly, just so it stands out slightly from the rest of our background. We're going to drag in another heading. Nope, not that. Heading inside here. We're going to have table of contents. And then we're going to have a text editor underneath the contents. And in here is where you can write the headings for all the subsections on your content, on your blog post. And this, we're going to put in a link for each of those so that someone doesn't need to read the entire blog post. They can skip to the part of the blog post that they are really interested in. This really helps increase our user satisfaction when it comes to our content. So we don't actually have our content yet, but that's what the idea is. So let's just put this together just to show you how it works in practice. So let's just say we have section one. We're just going to call it introduction. You would call it whatever you want. And let's do a section two. No, yeah, hello. And now we will go and we will just add another container underneath. I want it to be underneath. Don't want it to, yeah, there. We don't want it to be within this gray area because it's going on to our content. So we have another box here. We're going to drag over another heading. This one, we're going to make sure it's a H3. No, I'm going to leave that as a H2. We want our H1, this one, to be H1, because that is the heading of our overarching blog post. Any subheadings underneath that go as a H2. And then if you have a subsection within this section, you will call that a H3. It's called having a proper hierarchy of our content. And this helps optimize our posts for SEO. So this is going to be our topic, and we're going to say this one is introduction. Again, you can call this whatever you want, but I just want to demonstrate how we can create a table of contents that allows people to skip to whichever section they want. So we have this one. We want to select this. We want to insert a link, and we're going to put hash introduction. I'm going to insert that link. You can see now that if we hover over it, the little mouse cursor changes, so it's now a link. Then what we want to do is we want to select, Then what we want to do is we want to have a menu anchor just above this, because this will not appear in the front end on the real website. But it's going to allow us to link these parts of our website. So now I'm just going to click publish. We'll just see if this is set up correctly. Just going to preview the page and let's have a look. You can see now that if we click on this little bit here, it's going to bring us straight to the appropriate section of our blog post. So whenever you have created all of the content in your blog post, create the little sections here, put the link in with the menu anchor, and that will bring people exactly to the content that they are interested in. So let's create the rest of this template. So we're going to have a little more text area here. Then what we might have is another image. We put another heading, another text area. So we can just get rid of this editor now and we can look at what we have. The basic structure of our blog post. We have our H1 heading here, a small introductory sentence and an image. Then we go into our table of contents. We have a basic structure where we have a subheading, a little bit of text, an image, and you can add a bit more text underneath here perhaps where we write some more of our content. But you can see how easy it is to comprise and put together our blog post. And you can put some icons, you can put within our Elementor free, we have all of these different things available to us. If you choose to pay for Elementor Pro, you'll get a lot more different things that you can add in to your blog post. But to be fair, if your blog post has good content and good information within it, the design needs to be simple and clear. And having things like your table of contents is important to be able to help with the navigation of that. So what we're going to do now is we are just going to add one simple section at the bottom that prompts people to book that discovery call. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to a section. Let's see, on our about page. Whoops. Not that page, our home page. See this bit here, I'm going to pop this into the bottom of our blog page so that on every blog post, this will appear automatically without us having to, without us having to recreate it every time. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go, while I'm viewing my website like this, click on Edit with Elementor. I'm going to make sure this part is selected. And I'm going to save as template. And call this our book discovery section. And we're going to save that to our content library. Now we will go back to this blog post. I'm just going to click publish before I do anything here. Then I'm going to refresh the page. Now we're going to go down here and we're going to add a template. I'm going to click on my templates. And now you're going to see our book discovery section is there. We're going to click insert. We want to don't apply the settings, I don't think. Let me see what that looks like. Okay, so that's perfect. So now you can see that we have this section now nicely on the bottom of our blog post. So click publish just to save that. And all we want to do then, once we have our template designed, obviously it's an empty template, but it's given you an idea of how you drag and drop your items across from this editor into this section and how to create a table of contents. Now, here we go. We have our call to action. We have our blog post structure laid out with our contents area. We're just going to make sure that is published and saved. And now that will be within our template area. So every time we want to create a new blog post, all we need to do, go back to our WordPress, go into our posts and add a new post. I'm going to give it a title. Best recipes for weight loss, perhaps. Hit publish, publish again. Then we want to go to edit with Elementor. Now we want to add in our template. Click on templates and our blog post should be there. There we have it. Now we don't have to redesign this section every time. We'll just add in, this one doesn't seem to have gone in, so we'll pop that one in as well. Now we have our call to action and our blog post ready to start putting in the content of our blog post. We want to automate the process of someone being able to book our free discovery call. And the tool we're going to use for that is called Calendly. So we can do quite a lot with the free version of Calendly. You can have a look as well whether you think perhaps a paid option will give you more choices that you think you might need later on in the process. But for now, we're going to stick with the free one. So you want to hit get started and sign up for an account with them. I am going to log into my account. And once you're logged in, you want to hit this little plus icon here. We want to create our event as such. So we're going to create this one, event type, one-to-one, one host with one invitee. This is the one we're looking for. Of course, there are different options here if you have a group thing you want to use Calendly for. So we're going to click one-to-one, and it's going to be myself as the host. I'm going to click next. We are going to name our event. Free discovery call. We're going to say our free discovery call is 15 minutes. It's going to be done. You can either do it by phone call, but a lot of people like to do these via Zoom. It means you get to see people face to face. They get to see you face to face. So we're going to click on Zoom. And if you want to use Zoom, you need to integrate it with your Zoom account. So we're going to go ahead and do that. This will mean that people will automatically be sent the Zoom link in order to join our call. So I'm going to click connect Zoom for myself. We're going to log into our Zoom. I just need to verify with a one-time passcode. Calendly, it's gone into my promotions tab. Now we're going to integrate our Calendly with our Zoom. That's going to automate it. That's part of the process where people will automatically have our Zoom link that they need in order to join our free call. So we're going to create our new event again. One-to-one, just with me. Minutes, click Zoom. This time it is allowing us to select Zoom because we have our accounts integrated. Now we want to click on continue. So our event is ready. We just want to tweak some of the settings. We want to control when someone can book, how far into the future they can book, what time of the day they can book. Obviously, you want to only make sure that they can book at a time that you are free. Event details. We can create a little bit of instructions here. Save and close. Scheduling settings. This is how far in the future invitees can schedule their appointment. So you might want to have that just 30 calendar days into the future, or you can have that just weekdays into the future. Or you can set it as indefinitely. Do we want a buffer time? Do we want to have a little bit of time between calls? If you have a lot of calls, you might want to have a 15 minute break in between. Minimum notice. We want to make sure we have a little bit of time to get ready for our discovery call. You want to show them their own time zone. And we want them to start at 30 minute increments. You can adjust all of this as it suits you. You can have weekday hours, date specific hours. Our availability, currently unavailable on Sunday. I'd like to leave that way, but if you want to have them on Sunday or modify this to your needs. Now, once we have all of this set up accordingly, we want to go to, let's go back to the home and we'll find our event again. This is the one here and we want to click on share. And what we want to do is we can share the link directly with someone or we want to add it to our website. We want to select this one, inline embed. We're going to embed this on a specific page on our website. So just click this one and click continue. And this is a little bit of code that we want to copy. We can also modify this so that it is in line with our brand. So with this little blue color, it's obviously the color of Calendly, but we can change this so the blue is now our green for our branding color. So I'm going to go over to get our hex code there again for our green. And I'm going to pop that in there. Yep, copy code. Now we're going to head back over to our website. And we want to create a page that is dedicated to this booking section, this discovery call booking section. So we're going to go add a new page. We're going to call it free discovery call. Click on publish. Publish. We want to click on edit with Elementor. We want to add a section. We're just going to add a simple section here because we don't need too much content on here. We're really just going to embed the little bit of code. So we want to click on this add plus icon here, and we want to find the short code one. We want to drag that over into our section. And this is where we want to paste in the code from Calendly. You're going to see now that this has dragged this across from our Calendly and embedded it on our website. The only other thing I might like want to do here is just add a heading. I'm going to pop the heading in above there. And we're just going to say book free discovery call. What does that look like? I might just style it very slightly. I'm going to center that text. I'm going to bring it down slightly, I think. So I'm going to add a little bit of margin on the top. What does it look like? Yeah, that's perfect. So now we have the availability that we've set up through our Calendly. People can book their discovery call, and you will obviously receive an email whenever that is done. So you've automated this part of your business, this part of your sales funnel. And obviously you want to click publish. What we now want to do is we want to add this page to our menu. So we're going to go back into our WordPress dashboard. So we want to make sure we have a page called book. We have our free discovery call. And we want to add that to our menu. So if you remember, we need to go to appearances and then menus. And then we want to add this page to our menu. Now we don't want to leave the navigation label that. I'm just going to say book. You can have it as book a discovery call if you want, but I think that might be a bit too long of a title for the menu. So let's save that menu. Because if you think about it, will many people actually book our services and pay for a paid session with you straight off the bat from your website? It's more likely that people are going to book a free discovery call with you. And then what you can do is you can go back to your Calendly then, and you can set up a different event type that is your paid plan. And then you can either set up your payments through Calendly, or you can just send them an invoice or send them a link to your payments in order to collect that payment, rather than complicating this process anymore. So now we go back to our visit our site. And now we have all of these menu items here. I'm going to delete this button off of our menu, I think, because I don't really like it there. So what I'm going to do is go back to here, back into appearance and customize. Now we can see that as we hover over, now we are in our WordPress editor. We won't be able to edit this content here because this is done within Elementor. We can edit this menu, however, from here. If we click on this, you can see that this more options kind of pop up here. And you can see that this is a button widget. So I'm just going to delete that, so that we only have this simple menu without the phone number there. Or what you could do is leave the button there and have the button leading to our book page. So if you fancy doing that, we would need to select the add there, click button. It's going to add that button back again. I want to edit the button. Text do we want? We want to have book. The link wants to go to our booking page, such. So I'm just going to go to my website and I'm going to find that page and I'm going to get the link for it here. Copy that back over. I'm going to pop the link in there. So now we can see, we can hit publish. I'm going to delete this from the menu now because we don't need that in there. We have our call to action to book the discovery up right up in the menu as well. I'm just going to remove some of the border that is around the menu. So I've noticed on this page, you can see that the menu isn't the whole way to the top. So I'm just going to edit this and see the little bit of a margin at the top. Let's get rid of that. Hit publish. If we go back to our page here and click refresh, we can see now that our menu is now right tight up to the top of the page. Just going to go back to our menu again, and I'm going to remove that menu item. That isn't really the right color for a white background, is it? What I might do is go back, just customize that menu slightly so that it allows our items to appear a bit clearer. Click on our book page. So that's the page that opens. We want to change the background of that page. Background is white. We want it to have it darker, don't we? That looks much better. So we also want to edit very slightly the color of this, these menu items. So let's go into, we'll just click on them to make sure we have them selected. Go to design, and then text color, click on that. We just want to have that a little bit lighter, don't we? So now we can see that text a little bit easier. Looks better. We'll just publish that. All right, I just want to double check what our page looks like in real life. For some reason, our logo has gone from up here. So I'm just going to go back in here. Sometimes weird things happen with websites. Just going to change our image for our logo back to the one we have there. Choose our image. It's the wrong logo. We want the dark one. Back up into our, reselect the logo. Now we have the better image in there and it's a bit bigger. Okay, better. That looks great. I am going to go to the real website. Let me just, there we have it open. And we're going to refresh that to make sure our logo is out there. It is. And if anyone wants to click on the logo, that will take us to the home page. We also have the home there. You could delete the home there. To be fair, we don't really need the home there because the logo will always lead us back to the home page. But now we have our menu. We have our booker discovery call. Now I want to make sure that these buttons actually lead to that book page. So let's go back to our Elementor editor in our pages. Let's go to pages and we'll start on our home page. Right click, open a new tab. We want to click on this button and under link, we're going to click book or type book free discovery call. And that will mean that when someone clicks on this button, it will lead to that booking page. This one as well. This one as well. While I'm here, I want to just make sure that these are going to the right pages too. This one wants to go to the About page, which it already has selected. Perfect. So now we just want to go to any other pages that have that button and make sure it also links to this booking page. This one. We haven't created this shop aspect yet. And here we have it as well. We want to lead to the booking page. This one here, exact same. Make sure all of these links are correct. Publish. Once that's saved, check our contact page. We didn't put the button there. Which, to be fair, we probably should, shouldn't we? So I want to take the button that is on our homepage. I don't want to redesign a new button. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go back to my homepage and I'm going to right click on this little icon. Then I'm going to copy and then go to, was the contact page, wasn't it? I'm going to right click and see if it will paste it. It will. Lovely. So now I'm just going to, does that look okay? Or will I align it left? Yeah, maybe put it to the center. I'm not sure. You can leave it whatever way you think looks best. And that already has the correct link in it because we've copied it from the last page. And we're going to hit publish. It's always a good practice as well to go through your website to make sure all the links are correct. Okay, that's how we set up our booking automation on our website.
Selling our digital products can be a great way of earning some passive income. This can be in the form of a PDF, an ebook, or even an email series. And now I'm going to show you how you can set up selling digital products on your website.
So Amy's main services that she provides is obviously her nutrition consulting. However, if you have a similar type of business, you might want to think about starting to sell more digital products. Products that you can create once and sell over and over again without any further marketing or work on your part creates a little bit of passive income. So for Amy, we are going to allow her to sell digital products such as an ebook. She could sell an ebook as such, but she's going to sell recipes because obviously that aligns with her business. So in order to do that, I'm just going to go and log back into my dashboard. We already have WooCommerce installed. We already have the shop functionality installed. We have all the pages that we need. So what we want to do is we want to add our products first. And in order to add our products, we want to go over to simply underneath this WooCommerce, we have products. And we can go on add new. And this is all of the information that is to do with this product. So let's say she has a recipe, low calorie breakfast recipes. That's what she's going to title it. And we want to also think about, in order for people to find her recipes, what are people going to put into the search engine when they're looking for this? Would people actually put in to their search engine low calorie breakfast recipes? And I think that's possibly something that they might do. So you want to write all of the detailed description, exactly what is contained in this recipe or this digital product. Put it all in here, as much detail as you can, and make sure you're referring to this, we'll call this a keyword, this name of our product. And then here we can put in the price. So we're going to say these recipes are $24.99. It's a simple product, which means that we just sell it once. And that's it. But obviously this isn't a physical product, as it's a digital product or a virtual one. So obviously they're intangible. We're not shipping this to someone. They actually just download it themselves.
So we'll click on downloadable because it's virtual and downloadable. This is our price. If you ever want to have a sale price, you can pop that there. Let's say Amy is running a sale on her website and we're going to say we're selling them now for $19.99. And we can schedule a sale, but we'll continue this little website getting started sale thing. So now we have to make sure we have the file to our product here. If you want to know how to create a digital product like an ebook, just check my YouTube channel because I do actually have a video walking you through exactly how you can do that. So once you have that product created and you have it saved on your computer, we want to go to add file and we want to basically save it in here. So our file name will be no calorie. What did I call it? Low calorie breakfast recipes. And this is going to link to the file URL. We want to choose our file to make sure we actually have it on our website. We want to upload files. Make sure you find your file wherever it is on your computer. Now, this isn't actually a recipe, but it is a lead generator that I have, an ebook that I have created. So I'm going to have that saved as a PDF and I'm going to load that into my media library here. We want to give it a title. So for the sake of this, I'm going to say low calorie breakfast recipes. We have the file URL here. We're going to copy that. And then we're going to X out of there and we have that already popped in there. Now, how many times do you want to allow people to download it? We're going to say unlimited because it's a free it's a PDF. Expiry, does the link ever expire? No, we're going to leave that. Product short description, you're going to see how this is going to appear when we actually publish this product. But you'll see this is what appears immediately under the product name title. Short bit that really encompasses what your product does and is. Now, when we have our short product description in there, we want to add it into a category. We want to call this category recipes. We want to add a product image. We'll just pick something like that. That'll do. I'm going to pop some lorem ipsum in here just so we can demonstrate what this is going to look like. Okay. We are going to hit publish on that. Now we will click on view product. So let's have a look at this product page. So, okay, so this looks good. We're going to make a few modifications. This is set to dollars. Obviously, if you're in America, then that is fine. You might want to change that. So I'm going to change a few things here. You can see that the sale price has been added and there's a little sale thing here on the corner. We have this nice zoom effect on our image. So we're just going to go and we're going to modify our dollar sign there. What we need to do is we need to go into our WooCommerce settings. WooCommerce and settings. You want to make sure you have your address all set up in here. This is obviously set to America. That's fine. Put in whatever your address is here. Do you want to sell to all countries? Do you want to limit it to your country, to whichever country? This is obviously more to do with products, physical products that you're shipping. Enable taxes, it'll configure those kinds of things for you. Enable coupons. So if we want to offer a coupon code to certain people, we can do that here. This is already enabled. Come down to currency options, obviously set to US dollars. I'm going to just set mine to euro. That is all fine. Save changes. Now I'm just going to refresh this page and we can see that we now have our euro sign. And we can see that this little short description appears just underneath the price and our long description comes in at the bottom here. Seriously, want to provide enough details that you think will entice your potential customers to buy your product. I'm going to space this slightly differently here as well. So you can see here that our spacing is a little bit off. It's very close to the top here, isn't it? So we want to be able to edit some of this product page. The product page is currently being edited with our WordPress. So if you remember, to get to our WordPress editor while we're viewing our site, we can go up to the top bar here and click on Customize. And then we have all our options down the side here, and we want to click on WooCommerce. We want to click on Single Product. And here you're going to be able to adjust some of the items and the design of this page. And you can see here we can have it boxed, and you'll see that it kind of appears within a box. So actually the spacing is quite good as that. But if you didn't want that, we can leave it as default. You can see that we can add or hide some of the items here. So like our category, we can get that to not be visible. Up in here and recipes, the ratings. Do we want ratings? There's no ratings on it anyway, is there? So you can remove all of these items, meta description as you see fit. So you can play about with some of the design there, but what I'm actually gonna do is I like this unboxed thing, but it's a little bit tight to the top. So I'm gonna click on design. I'm gonna modify some of the spacing here. So I'm gonna unclick this. You can see it's blue at the minute. This one means if we space some of the padding on this, it will do the same for each of the other ones. They're kind of linked together. So I'm gonna unlink them. And on my top, I wanna have 100 pixels of spacing. And on the bottom, I wanna have 100 pixels of spacing, and then click publish. Now we can't see any changes yet, but I'm gonna refresh the page. And we can now see that we have a lot more spacing at the top and the bottom. Just makes it look a little bit more professional. It's not all squashed together. And while we're here, we can take a look at what our cart and our checkout pages look like, because once these are the add to cart and all those buttons will actually look quite good without us actually doing much at all. So let's go back out of this. We can see that looks really good now. If we go add to cart, now that's added to our cart, we can click view cart. And this is what our cart page will look like. And to be fair, this looks really good, I think. I am not going to change anything here. We can click proceed to checkout, and this will be our checkout page. And of course, there's no actual button to buy because we haven't actually set up any of our payments yet. But you can see here that this is all the information that we want people to fill in when they're purchasing. Place order, of course not, because there's no payment methods available yet, and we have to actually fill some of this in. So the next thing we want to do is we want to make sure we've set up our payment processing so that someone can actually go ahead and start purchasing our items.
When it comes to the payment processor that we're going to use for our website, there's a number of different choices. And the choices that you pick will depend on whether perhaps you currently use one of these options and you want to keep all of your payments in one place. So three potential options are Woo Payments, Stripe, and PayPal. So if you currently use one of these already, then you might want to stick with that one. But if you don't already use Stripe or PayPal for your payment processing, then I'm going to show you how to set up Woo Payments on your website. And it's going to keep all of your payment details on your WordPress dashboard so that you don't need to go to another platform in order to see your payment details. All of these different payment processors will take a small percentage of all the money that you earn. From what I've seen, they all seem to take a similar amount, and it's not really anything that we can get around.
Now that we have our products ready to sell on our website, we just want to set up our payment processing. To do that, we want to come over to WooCommerce and just select WooCommerce. And this is going to walk us through a little bit of a setup wizard to get it all started. Just click set up my store. You can select which one is relevant for you. I'm just going to click on I'm just starting my business. They just want to know a few details. Just going to fill these in. Opt in. No, thank you. So this is going to offer to download the plugin Woo Payments, which is a payment software that will allow you to keep all of your payment details within your dashboard. So it keeps everything all together.
But we don't want all of them. We don't need this Pinterest one. We don't need any of these because it would download all of those as well. So we just want to keep this WooPayments one. Click continue. So we're going to set up our WooPayments then by clicking on this button, get paid. And we need to have a WordPress.com account in order to be able to use WooPayments. But WooPayments is going to be able to allow us to take all of these different payment methods and we'll pay directly into our bank account. So it's a super simple, easy way to set up payments on your store. I'm going to just click on connect your store. And if you already have a WordPress.com account, you can just connect it or it will prompt you to sign up for an account. So this is just allowing, connecting my WooPayments with my WordPress.com account. And I'm going to just approve that. You want to select whether you're an individual or a company or a nonprofit. I'm going to select individual. What types of products? We are selling food kind of products. So just try and find the type of good or services closely matches what you sell. Just click on continue. Just asking me to log in. Just basically follow any of these prompts here. This is actually signing in with my Stripe because I already have a Stripe account. Because I've used Stripe before, it already has my details. So I'm just going to select the details there that I have. Otherwise, you can create a new business and just follow those prompts. And just make sure all of these details are correct. And you add in your bank account here. This is the bank account that it will get paid out into. And you want to agree and submit. It might take a few days or a few hours for the account to be verified. Just check some of your details. So you can see here a bit of a dashboard here. So it's going to tell you, you know, things that your balance, things that the available amounts that you have. So all of this is pending at the minute. And you can see here what the fees will be. You get discounted fees until October. Okay. So that is all ready to go. We just need to allow it to verify. We want to start optimizing our website now. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to start optimizing some of the SEO for our website. And through this section, you may realize that there may be some changes to the text on the front end of your website. The front end, I mean, is the bit that is kind of displayed to the public. But just work through this section and just make note of any changes that you may need to make. So the first thing we need to do is we need to install a plugin that's going to help us simplify this process. So we're going to go down the left-hand side to plugins and add new. We want to search for a plugin called Yoast SEO. And this is the one here we want. We want to click on install and then activate. Now, what we need to do is we need to go through our pages one by one and set up some of the back end information that's going to help our search engine optimization performance. So we'll just go over two pages and we want to go through each of our pages. So we're going to start with our home page. And instead of clicking edit with Elementor, what we're actually going to do is we're going to click on the name of the page, which is our home. And you're now going to notice that underneath our little editor section, which we're not really using, underneath this section, we're going to have this new section called Yoast SEO. And our homepage then, that's really the sort of hub of our website where people are going to come to first. So if you need to think about what are the things that people put into the search engines when they're looking for services that you provide. So for our dietitian, We might want to have in this area, focus key phrase, registered dietitian in, let's select a location, let's say London, because that could be literally what someone puts into their search engine. And if you think about this with regards to your blog posts as well, when you're writing a blog post, always have in the back of your mind, what are people looking to find? What are they looking to find out? What information are they looking to find? And what are they going to type into their search engine? And can you put those keywords into the title of your post, in throughout your post, and also in this section here? And it's going to prompt us to kind of do this well, if that makes sense. So we can see here that this is how our website will appear in a search result. So we have the title of the page in Amy Forrest Registered Dietitian. We don't have a meta description yet. What needs to go into our meta description is we want to include our keywords and we want to inform someone that is searching for, say, a registered dietitian, that this is what they're looking for. So let's try and put together a meta description. So we see here that this green line gives us an indication of the best length for our meta description so that it's not going to be cut off in the search results. And we want to include some kind of call to action or spaces available now or something that'll kind of say, right, you know, we're ready to work with you. And this is going to offer us a little bit of an analysis on our SEO as it is now. And obviously there are some of these that will not apply to you, but some of them is worth going through. So you want to think about what your key phrase is, and we've sort of selected there that our key phrase is registered dietitian in London. So we want to go back through our homepage and make sure that we have that in the text on the front end of our website. So we have registered dietitian. Perhaps we could go back in there and add in the London bit. The same as on the home page and the contact page, it all reinforces that Amy is a registered dietitian in London. So Google knows that that's what she does and that's the services that she provides. And Google will make sure that the customers looking for that will find her. You will see here that there's no outbound links. That could be things like linking to some kind of registered body for dietitians or whatever service area niche that you're in. It could be to your social media. So things like your Facebook and different social media links. Key phrase in the introduction. This will walk you through exactly those things that we talked about, keeping your key phrase really clear the whole way through your homepage. So you can go back through and make sure that this is being applied through your website. We also want, while we're here, we want to set a featured image, and that's the image that will appear here. Because this might not be the one that you want to appear, Google will take an image from the page, but you can set a featured image, and it's more likely that Google will use that image for its search results. So I'm going to just select a different one there and set our featured image. And you can see that that has now changed here. You can see here, images on this page do not all have alt attributes with at least half of the words from your key phrase. So you can go back through your images on all of your pages and make sure that they have alt text that include your key phrase as well. And you can see here that this is the thing that we have done well according to this plugin. So it's a really good way of just prompting you to improve your SEO on the back end of your website. When you've done any of your changes, make sure you click on Save. I'm going to go through the other pages now and make some similar edits. And you can do the same here with this section. Make sure that you include some internal and outbound links. Internal links might be something like linking to some of your blog posts that are relevant, linking to different sections on your website, like your recipes. We're going to go and set our featured image. Let's say that's our Amy Forrest. We see we have our alt text on that. Now let's click on Save. And it's really important that you go through each of those steps, especially when you're creating each of your blog posts, because blog posts can be a really effective way of generating new traffic to your website. But we want to make sure it's SEO optimized, and we want to make sure that we're ranking for the keywords that we want to. If you want to dive into your SEO of your website a little bit more, the Yoast SEO website is actually a great one that will help you and prompt you to do things that will improve the SEO of your website. One other thing we want to do with Yoast, and this is now linked to the next section of this tutorial, is this is where we want to set up our website to work with Google Search Console. This is basically like having a formal introduction to Google. So we're going to say, Google, this is a new website. Please index it. Please show it to our customers. And we're going to use Yoast SEO as part of this process. So what we want to do is we want to go to Google Search Console. And I would advise using the URL prefix for our Google Search Console. If you don't have an account, it will prompt you to sign up for an account. I'm already logged in, so it just brought me straight to this page. We want to put in the URL of our website. If you don't know what that is exactly, you should do, but it's going to be up here. I'm just going to copy that. And I'm going to pop it in there. And we're going to hit continue. It's going to prompt us to verify that we own the website. And how we do that is we're going to use a HTML tag for this one. So this is second option down here. So we want to copy this tag here and pop back over to our website. We need to download another plugin in order to put this little bit of code onto our website. So we're going to go add new plugin. Headers. This is a simple plugin that will just allow us to put a little bit of code in the header of our website code. I like this one. It's nice and simple and works really straightforward. I'm going to click on install now and activate. We want to go into settings of the plugin, and this is the scripts in the header. You can see here that this asks us to put it in the head section, so before the body section. So we want to put it in the script in this header section. We want to paste that in there. And then we want to click on Save Changes and go back to our Search Console and verify. So if that's been done correctly, it should now just come up with ownership verified. Basically, Google now knows that we own and have access to the back end of this website. We're going to click on Go to Property because we're going to submit our sitemap. So if we just go over to this sitemap section, you're going to be able to come back to this over time, but it will take a little bit of time to start taking in the data basically of your website and giving you some information. So let's go over to sitemaps for now, and we're going to enter in our sitemap. But what we're going to do is we're going to use Yoast SEO for this. So if we click on Yoast, we want to go to... Oh yeah, if we go to settings, then we can just quick search. We're going to do sitemaps. So we're going to go back over to our website and click on view our actual XML sitemap. And we can see that we have 6 sitemaps. And we have these within each of those sitemaps. We have URLs within each of those sitemaps. So we want to submit all of these into our sitemap. So we're going to copy each of them. And then we're going to submit them in here. Click on submit. Invalid. Oh yeah, because I have the first part in as well. Don't need that bit. Just going to make sure we have all of our posts submitted. We want to go back and we want to get, whoops, not that one. This one here. All of our pages. Submit that one as well. All of our products is this next one. And basically you want to just copy and paste all of these into Google Search Console. This is basically saying to Google, please index this website. And it's going to see the pages that are within these, okay? You can see our post here that it's discovered 3 of our pages. I realized that these URLs for these sitemaps are actually wrong. I've put in the last part of the actual URL to the website here, and I should have started from this / product sitemap. So these won't obviously work because they're the wrong URLs. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to just pop in the correct one here. No, yeah, it's got the / product. No, sitemap. And the other one I had there was page. and hopefully these will work. And basically we want to leave that now for a while because it will start generating some data for us. But we can see the Google Search Console will give us feedback on parts of our website that need work, need improved, need something done to it, how it's performing, the different pages, what pages have issues on them. It's a good tool to have. And if you have any issues, you can't understand something with regards to Search Console, do use basically Google to help you find any answers that you might need. Next thing we want to do is, again, about optimizing our website. And more importantly, optimizing our website so that it loads fast, so for speed. And this does have an impact on the search engine optimization, because if your website is really slow, then people aren't going to take the time to let the information load to actually use it. And that'll have a negative experience on the way Google sees your website. So with SiteGrind, it automatically puts this plugin, the Speed Optimizer one, and we're going to go through this one now to make sure we have all of the optimization options ticked and completed as best we can. So we're just going to click on this plugin, Speed Optimizer. And we can see here that we have two of the four caching things completed as such. And it shows us here that there are other things that we need to do now in order to improve our website. So let's just go to caching to start off with. And now, depending on which hosting plan you chose right at the start will influence how many of these caching options you have. From what I can remember, there may not be the memcached one on the most basic plan, but you will still have enough caching services even on the basic plan. And don't worry if you don't have the ones that you see here. So anything that we see recommended, basically we want to tick. And you can see here that this has brought up an error. That's because we haven't activated this within our SiteGrind account. So that's what we're going to go to next. Let's go back here and let's go back to our SiteGrind. We're just going to log into our account. You want to go to your websites. I have a number of websites, so I will pick the one that I need. You may not. Just go into your WordPress. No, not your WordPress. Sorry, your site tools. If you come over to this left-hand side, you have a number of different options here. So just click on this one that says speed, and you'll see caching. And you'll see here that we have this memcached one that's not actually activated here. So we're going to activate it within our SiteGrind. And then whenever I go back over, I'll be able to activate that now on my WordPress dashboard. While we're in our SiteGrind account, there's a few other things we want to do. So we'll see within the security, you can see here that we have a backups option. And this is where if you are updating your website or if you're making significant changes to it, you might want to create a backup. And you can do that by just giving it a title and selecting backup, so create. And you can have 5 manual backup slots, which is more than enough. And what happens then is if something goes wrong, once you've made changes or updated your website, you can refer to the previous version of your website. And it will really help avoid, you know, big issues that you find really hard to fix or where you might actually need to hire someone in to fix your website for you. If you always create a backup before you do anything on your website, it is very good practice to avoid, you know, a really big crash. The other one we have here is SSL Manager. So you'll see here that we have this certificate activated on our website already. This is our SSL certificate, okay? So we already have that activated. Underneath there, we have HTTP Enforce. And we want to make sure this is selected because this is going to force our website to work over a secure connection. And that's what's going to keep our website secure. And all of the details, payment details, or any other details that your customers may, you know, give over on through your website, that's going to keep all of that secure. Over on the left-hand side here, you can also see this little WordPress icon. And this is where you can manage your installation of WordPress, but also our staging section. And this is where we can create a staging version of our website. Let's say, for example, there is an update to some of the plugins or You want to make some drastic changes to your website. You might want to create a staging copy of your website. Make the changes to that website first, just to make sure that everything works. And then you can push the staging copy to live. So you would put in the name and select create, and then you can log into that version of the website, make those changes and make sure it all works as it should. So that is your staging. It's all within your SiteGround account. Your DNS zone. I am creating this website on a temporary domain, so I can't actually see this. But if you ever need to access, or anyone else ever needs to access, your DNS zone editor, that is where it's going to be, under domain and in here. We can create an email account associated with our website. And to do that, all we need to do is go to accounts. And I can't show you that because, again, I'm using a temporary domain. But you will be able to create your account and you will have a free email that is associated with your domain. And you can then create that as, you know, your name at your domain or info at your domain, whichever that might be. And that's totally free to create within SiteGround. You're going to have some other statistics and different things within your SiteGround account as well. So let's pop back over to our WordPress. Let's go to environment next. So we have our HTTP done on our SiteGround. We also need to enforce it on our WordPress. It's going to log us out and get us to log back in again once we enforce this. There we go. Just need to log back in again. Fix insecure content. We want to just select this one as well. Next, we want to go to our front end option. And these are some ways we can speed up our website, how it will enable our website to move a little bit faster. So we're going to do the ones that are recommended here. And this is just going to allow our website to appear on the screen much faster. Be careful. Sometimes with the JavaScript ones, it can stop certain things happening on your website. So JavaScript generally is to do with things that are interactive on your website. So things that move when you click on them, things that appear, funky animations and stuff. It shouldn't affect our website too much because we haven't really added that kind of thing. But just to be aware that that's what our JavaScript is involved with. So if you ever find things that aren't working as they should, you can come around here and deactivate some of these and just check whether that may help resolve the problem. We want to do all these recommended ones also. Web fonts optimization. I'm going to select this one. I'm going to leave the rest. Then we're going to go to media. This is mostly involving our images. And we have this handy image compression within our SiteGround. So we are going to make sure that this is enabled. So just click on edit, compression level. I'm going to go for medium. We want to back up the original images. I don't think we need to back up the original images. We want to compress our existing images. Override images with custom compression level. So this might take a little bit of time, but it's going to automatically compress our, I'm going to go with high. Let's make sure that works and confirm. WebP images. This next part then is a new format of image file, and it is the best format when it comes to our web. While we're just waiting for that to happen, it's going to compress our images. There we go. I'm going to click this one, confirm. Lazy load. This will only load the piece of information on your website that is visible at the time. It's going to make your website load faster. We're going to click enable. And that's fine. So that's basically, we've used all the opportunities that SiteGround offers to us within our hosting platform to speed up our website and get it working really professionally. Next thing we want to do is we want to enable a cookie banner on our website. And this is depends on where you are in the world. I know this is law in Europe. Due to GDPR, we need to get permission to use cookies basically on our website. And those are Do you know where your browser saves information from websites, saves information of yours, what you're looking at in order to be able to use for, you know, advertising purposes? A lot of that is to do with cookies. But also, our website functionality uses cookies for different things. So different functionalities need cookies to be used. So that's why you'll see there'll be functional cookies on a website that you can agree to. Some are advertising ones. So we need to set up this on our website. If you're in a country that you don't need a cookie policy and a cookie banner, then that's fine. You can skip this section. We're going to go over to our plugins and we're going to use a plugin called Compliance, I think you call it. So if we look for that one. Oh, no. A new plugin first. I like this one because it walks us through a nice setup wizard that gets everything up and ready and compliant. Install now and activate. Now what we want to do is we want to set up our wizard. So just go to wizard tab at the top. This is where you need to comply with the correct laws of your country. So select the country that you are in or the default for your customers. Privacy law or guideline do you want to use as a default for your worldwide visitors? I'm going to select EU because that's where I am. Do we target visitors from Germany, Austria, blah, blah, blah? No. We don't need this one. Save and continue. Our cookie policy, we want it to be generated with the plugin. Privacy policy, we do have one. We just need to publish it. So I'm going to select none for now. We'll come back to that. Imprint, don't need that. Don't need that. Save and continue. We need to fill in some of our details here. Save and continue once you have that done. Do you want to enable records of consent? That's going to be an upgraded one, so we don't need that. We should be able to use our free plugin for all of this. We're going to respect, do not track, and global privacy control. Click save and continue. This is going to scan our website. It's found 32 cookies on your domain. I'm going to click on continue. Do we use Google Tag Manager? Do we compile statistics of this website? Nope. We do not. I suppose we kind of do using Google Search Console, don't we? So yes, but not with any of the above. Or click on continue, save and continue, save and continue. You will automatically know that we are using Google Fonts. If you're using any of these, you can click on these as well, but we are not. Will you self-host Google Fonts? No. This is because Google Fonts is recognized as going against some of the GDPR laws. So we want to make sure that we're notifying people of that. And if they do not accept the cookies on the website, it won't load Google Fonts. Does your website contain embedded social media content? Nope. Does your website contain strips for advertising? Nope. Do we use WordPress comments? You can, but we particularly are not. So if you are using your comments in your posts, you would want to select yes, but we're going to stick with no. We're going to save and continue. And you'll see here that all of these different parts of our website, different plugins, use cookies. So if someone selects that they don't allow cookies, some of our website may not work exactly as it should. Just click continue. This is going to create our cookie policy. Save and continue. Show consent banner, yes. We're going to enable the cookie and script blocker. That's going to stop things from working if people do not accept the cookie policy. Click on finish. This is our cookie policy banner here, and you can change how it will appear. It's our title, the different categories. You can see what they are, view preferences. You know, you can fiddle about with lots of these little things. Display options, hover on desktop, hide on mobile. We're going to click save and continue. Most of this will be absolutely fine. This is only about tweaking a little bit of the design. The only thing you might want to change possibly is this little blue button here to the color that your website brand obviously works with, that green color. So let's see if you wanted to change the button background color here. We would go back to our template, grab our code. Told you we'd be using this a few times. Copy that. Paste that in there. And you can see now that the button has changed color. You want to change the border color as well. But like I say, that's just optional. Save and continue. We're just going to leave this all as it is. We don't need to worry about any of that. We're just going to save. And that is that done. You can always go in and modify any of this at any time through this compliance tab on the side. Another thing we want to ensure on our website is that we have a privacy policy. So what we're going to do is we're going to go over to pages and you're going to see that there actually is a privacy policy already created. Handy, this is nearly always put onto any WordPress installation that I've ever used. So we want to just click on the title here because this is, we're happy to leave this all editing within the WordPress editor. And you can see that it has suggested text. Now, for legal reasons, I'm not going to tell you how to devise your privacy policy and what the exact text needs to go in here. However, what I tend to do is just leave what is auto-populated by WordPress. But I can't legally tell you that that's, you know, the best thing for you and your business to do. So do some research yourself. Make sure that you have an adequate privacy policy. I'm just going to go through and I'm going to delete all these suggested text bits. Once we're done with that, we're just going to hit on publish. And you remember when we set up our compliance, our cookie policy, no, our cookie banner, we want to make sure that we put that privacy policy into the right place within our cookie policy plugin. So we're going to find that again. Compliance. We'll just run through the wizard again and make sure we have that where it was meant to be. Privacy policy, an existing page. Select the page from the dropdown. So now that will link to the privacy policy that we've just created. Other legal pages that you may want to create are things like a return and refund policy if you're selling products, some kind of, you know, terms and agreements policy. The final thing we want to do with our website is we want to really go through it with a fine tooth comb and make sure that everything is working. All of our buttons are working and linking to the right pages. All of the text is correct. There's no spelling errors. The other thing we also want to test is the shop function. And in order to do that, we're going to create a coupon code. So in order to do that, we need to go over to marketing and then coupons. We're going to create our first coupon. And this is where if you ever want to offer someone a free product or a discount off of a product, you can create your coupon code and then send them that to use in your cart. Free product. Fixed percentage discount coupon amount 100% because we're going to give it a free product and it's going to allow us to test our shop function as well and see how this looks. So now what we're going to do is we're going to go hover over here and then visit our site. I'm going to click right click and open a new tab. This is how our website looks now. We have our cookie policy. We're going to accept that to make sure our site works. Now what we're going to do, like I said, go through and make sure everything is absolutely perfect. All of these buttons, that button doesn't work. We need to go back and make sure this goes to the services page. This one goes to the recipe page. This one goes to the Book or Discovery page, but that one is correct. And you can see that popping up there beautifully. We also just need to edit our logo on our footer section. So we might just do that now quickly. So remember this part, our header and our footer are actually edited using the WordPress editor, not Elementor. So we will just go to up here. We will go to customize. Now, if we scroll down, you can see when we hover over this logo, the little pencil icon comes up. If we just select that, it's going to allow us to change the logo in here. So let's just delete that one. Let's see if we can add from our media, our logo. We need the logo now that looks good on a white background. So we're going to have that one. There we go. That's popped in there. Perfect. We want to change this little bit of text here as well. I just want to select this copyright widget. We have the current year in there. That's perfect. We want to put in, I'm going to click publish. The other thing we can do is actually add our recipes page to our menu, because that is, you know, a significant part of the website. So what I might do now is we've saved that. I'm going to go back to our WordPress. I'm going to remove the home, because I think most people realize these days that you can always click on the logo in order to get to the home page. So I'm going to just go back to our dashboard, go to appearance and menus. Going to remove home. We're going to add our recipes. View all, which is actually our shop page. Add to menu. We just put that in capitals, the same as the rest of the menu items. Make sure we save the menu. Now we'll go back over to our front end of our website. Make sure that has been applied. You can see, oh, recipes isn't there. What's that? Oh yeah, because it's called shop. Sorry, yes. We can change the name of that then to be recipes. Save. Refresh our page. There we go. And you can change the order of these if you like as well. And our footer now looks perfect as well. I think that looks great. Now we will test out our shop function to make sure that it's working. So you can see now when someone comes to this page here, we have the title here, which is shop. We could change that to recipes if it's only going to be recipes on the shop page. If it's going to be more than one item or different items, you could just leave it as shop, or you can call it whatever you want. So let's just go and we're going to add this to our cart because these recipes look amazing. Now, we obviously want a way to get to our cart. So the next thing we might do is we might add a cart icon up here. So let's go back to our menu. We're going to go to appearance, customize. I'm just going to edit this menu here. So we want to add in an item here. Click on that. We're going to add our cart. You can see now that we automatically have our cart information up on the header now. So I'm going to click publish. We're going to go back then. So there, that means that when someone has popped something into their cart, it will automatically appear on the header area. So we can just click on that, view cart. I think I've got that in there a few times now. So we want to make sure we amend that. Something is not working on this page. Let's go back to customize and see what's going on here. So while I was testing the website there, I realized that there was items, the cart page wasn't showing our items in our cart as it should. Do you remember I said before, if there are any things that are not working on your website, that a solution to try to find it, you know, a solution could be to go back into our speed optimizer. And do you remember this JavaScript stuff? So what I did in order to get these to appear as they should, we can now view cart, and we see the items that have been added to our cart are coming up here. So what I did was I actually deactivated some of this JavaScript files. So now we can see that this is working and it's going through into our cart page. We're going to proceed to checkout to make sure that this works. We got a coupon, don't we? So we're going to pop in the coupon. What was our coupon? Free product. Free product. We're going to apply that. We can see that we don't have to pay anything now. So you can see that this works fine. We are just going to pop in some details here just to test the process, and you'll see how the orders will appear. I'm going to click on place order. And now you'll see once the order's been placed, they'll be able to see this information and where they can actually download their their recipe that's going to download straight onto my computer. So that's working perfectly. The only thing that we haven't tested there is our payment processing, because obviously this was free to use. So what I would recommend doing is going through this process again and actually add to cart and pay yourself, because it's obviously your own product. Pay yourself, view cart, proceed to checkout. Do all this again, and we are not going to have our coupon code this time. And here's where we can add in our details. And actually pop in your details there. Make sure this all actually works. And then place your order. And then you can see, once we go back into our dashboard, we'll be able to see our orders appearing. If we go down into analytics and orders, this is where you'll see any of your orders that have to come through and any earnings as well. Everything is here on one section of our website. The other thing you want to do is you want to get your mobile and you want to go to your domain, your website domain, and double check that everything looks good on an actual mobile phone, not just using, you know, the editor to double check the mobile optimization like we had before. So actually go through your mobile. And then another thing you should do is send the link to your website to someone you know and get them to check it. Go through all the links, all the text, even put in a order. Make sure everything is working completely smoothly. If you have any issues with anything not working, put me a comment below and I'll definitely work with you to make sure we can get this working 100%. The plugins and the software used for your website will constantly be being updated by the software developers who created them. So we need to, on a regular basis, go into our website and update all of our plugins and make sure that our version of WordPress is also up to date. This is going to make sure that our website is working as it should and it is as secure as possible. So in order to do that, we're going to go over to our SiteGround dashboard and into the site tools. And this is the safest way to conduct any of your updates. And I would recommend maybe once a week going in and making sure that everything is up to date on your website. So we're going to go over to security and then backups. And we're going to make a backup of our website. If you ever find problems with your website, you'll see here that backups are taken every 24 hours of your website anyway. But this is where we're going to take a backup just before we make our changes. And this is going to save the version of our website as it is now. So now you can see that we have this version of our website here. And we can always restore all files and databases if something goes wrong when we update our website. We're going to pop over to our dashboard now and we're going to go over. You see here there are some plugins, that this little number 3, that means there's a couple of plugins that just need to be updated. So we're just going to click on plugins and you'll see here that Elementor needs updated, so we're going to click on update now. Starter templates also needs updated, so we'll click update, and this version of WooCommerce also needs updated, so we're going to click update now. They're all updated. If you ever have to update your WordPress version, it will appear on this front dashboard as well, prompting you to update. So there we have updated the plugins on our website. So what we want to do now is we want to go and view our website and just make sure that everything is working as it should. So just go through and test a few bits and pieces, go to some of the different aspects of your website and just make sure that everything is working as it should. Congratulations, you now have a professional looking website, all built by you. But there's more to learn and do. Your website shouldn't be static. It should grow and develop as you and your business does. And by building your own website, you've gathered all the skills you need to be able to do just that. If you check out some of the other videos on my channel, you're going to find videos that will help you optimize your website even further. So please do check out some of these other tutorials and don't forget to subscribe.